السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على نبيه الذي اصطفى نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه أما بعد. الله سبحانه وتعالى's prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says in a hadith which is sound and it is in مشكات المصابيح hadith number 163. He says on the narration of المقداد رضي الله عنه. He says, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. That I have been indeed given the Qur'an and something that is equal to it. Of course, traditional scholars understand this hadith that Allah's Prophet was given the Qur'an and he was given the hadith which is equal to the Qur'an. Because in the same hadith, the Prophet ﷺ mentions, a time will come when a man who will be well-fed and he will be reclining restfully, he will say that whatever we find in the Qur'an, we should follow, and that's it. And the Prophet ﷺ said, surely whatever the Prophet forbids and allows is as equal to whatever Allah and His book allows or forbids. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَإِنَّمَا يَسَّرْنَاهُ بِلِسَانِكَ لِتُبَشِّرَ بِهِ الْمُتَّقِينَ. That the Quran and the Hadith are coming from the same physiological human being and one individual, which is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, is it possible that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who spoke the Quran, which is God's word, Allah's word, alhamdulillah, did do it 100% without fault? But when it comes to hadith, there are many people who cause doubts about hadith collection, about hadith transmission, and the equality of hadith with the Quran and how these two things go hand in hand. Of course, this hadith is sahih. And the Prophet claimed, right? Let's say, I mean, we believe without any proof that the Prophet is saying the truth. But let's say, this was back in the old days, philosophically, issue that people would do intellectual gymnastics on. And even now, some people try to get those old archaic ideas from deviant sects like the Mu'tazila, and then they discuss them. But we live in an age of computational linguistics. We live in the age of data science. We live in an age of data visualization. We live in an age where we now can use machine learning and machine analysis to even solve forensic cases. For instance, there was this one person who was notorious. For 17 years, law enforcement could not catch him. But eventually, because of his letter that he wrote to his brother, they were able to analyze that letter and apprehend the criminal and of course serve justice. Similarly, one of our Muslim professors, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him, in an Arab country, he is a computational linguist. He took it upon himself to test this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he took the Quran, as we know from the narration of Hafs bin Asim, which all and everybody and the printing press from King Fahd printing press in Saudi Arabia, Medina, produces worldwide. And then he took the collection of hadith from Sahih al-Bukhari, which has many ahadith that are narrated by a single sahabi, which is ahad, as well as, which is mutawatir from many, many, many sahaba. And he did some computational linguistic analysis to see what the results are. Now, unfortunately, one of the tragedies of the Muslim Ummah is that our people do not like to read or learn. So Muslims are not only lagging behind in science and data and all these other fabulous areas of expertise, but they are also lacking in the knowledge of Sharia, and they are tremendously lacking in putting the two pieces together to complete the mosaic and actually have a very positive outcome for all of us. Let's come back to the research. The research was so extensive that I had to literally make it very simple for this presentation. So this individual takes the Quran and he says Sahih Bukhari, right? And then he does data visualization, data analysis, computational linguistic analysis, forensic analysis, and let's look at these results that are going to be in front of all of us to make up our mind. When the data visualization was done on the Quran and Hadith, it was very notably seen that the oneness of Allah and the number one was mentioned much more profusely and much more numerously in the Quran compared to the Hadith. Now remember, this is the same individual. It is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam who is speaking the Hadith, and it's being recorded by the Sahaba, and he is speaking the Quran, and it's being recorded by the Sahaba as well, by memory, and then later on parchment, and then in the form of a book. Then the analysis takes another look. What if there is a percentage of words that are in the Hadith, but they are not in the Quran? What about the words of the Hadith in Sahih Bukhari that are not in the Quran, and words of the Quran that are not in the Hadith? So there was a percentage that was driven from that analysis. What if there is a mention of animals in the Quran that were never mentioned in the Hadith? And what about the mention of the animals in the Hadith that were never mentioned in the Quran? So the net result comes out to be what? It turns out that the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ, that I have been given the Quran as well as something that is equal to it in its uniqueness, right? That is proven by this analysis, because the data shows us that it would have been impossible for one individual to totally maintain one form of speech for one book if the allegation is that the Prophet ﷺ wrote the Quran, and then maintain exactly 100% unique style of speech when it comes to Hadith. It is impossible for one human being through 23 years, right? From the time he became the Prophet till he passed away, to maintain that level of precision in his speech at different intervals of his day. It is impossible, can never happen. The probability is unbelievably low. So after we have all this data, the haters will still hate. But the most important thing is, what is a Muslim who now is faced, besides all of that philosophical discussion, with data? Like Lord Kelvin, who's a chemist, he says, I don't care what science you know, if you cannot interpret it in numbers, then all of your learning is vain. What you have done as science experiments is of no use. So following Lord Kelvin's principle, now we actually have data analytics, data visualization, statistical analysis, computational linguistics. We have all of that, and it is showing us very clearly that this one man, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had a unique experience. There was something given to him that was 100% unique, and from the same human body and the same tongue comes out another set of data that is very unique from the first one, and that is the Hadith. Therefore, the preservation of the Quran and Sunnah mathematically is proven without the doubt. And one more thing in ending, when Musa alayhi salam was in Mount Sinai, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, bring out your hand. And when Allah blessed his hand became luminescent and white. As soon as he would take it out of his pocket, it would illuminate, and the glare from the hand would blind the people of Pharaoh when they were looking at it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not only bless only the tongue of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he also blessed his heart and his consciousness and his mind. So source of the Quran and Sunnah is the same. It is the same tongue, the blessed tongue of the Prophet ﷺ. It is the same blessed heart of the Prophet ﷺ. It is the same blessed mind of the Prophet ﷺ. So anybody who tries to rip a rift between the Quran and Sunnah and tries to do this philosophical discussion now has failed, because we have data that speaks volumes, and the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ has now obviously mathematically demonstrated that Allah gave him the Quran and the Sunnah. May Allah give us preservation and steadfastness on this path. Ameen.